3 minutes more from the next set of speakers, if you would permit me for my second talk. I'll just finish that in 3 minutes. So the next talk is on chemical injuries. So actually, chemical injuries is actually the true ophthalmic emergency, and it is the only way, injury where you can delay detailed history and examination. And so the injuries can vary from being an alkali injury to the acids to the irritants. The alkalis ones are the most dangerous, and the most common one that we encounter is the Chuna practice. So why are the alkalis, why are they a problem? Because they penetrate rapidly, sometimes less than a minute, particularly ammonia, and then they combine with these cell membrane lipids, the mucopolysaccharides and to collagen, and they cause disruption of the cells and the necrosis of the tissue. On the ocular surface, they cause saponification of the cell membranes and intercellular bridges, and this facilitates rapid penetration into the deeper layers, aqueous and vitreous as well. So necrosis of the conjunctival vessels also, blood vessels also takes place, giving a cooked fish eye appearance. The acids, they just denature proteins, they don't penetrate that much because they form a precipitate. The irritants, they just mainly cause some irritation over there, like a pepper spray or something, so they don't cause much damage. The severity of the burn depends on the surface area of the contact, the depth of penetration, the concentration of the substance, the time of contact, the time of interference, and the degree of the limbal stem injury. In fact, the most important point over here that comes up is the limbal stem injury, limbal stem cell injury. So the clinical picture can vary a lot from being pain, lacrimation, photophobia, blepharospasm, your diminution of vision. You can have corneal edema, you can have symblepharon formation. That's all, it's a varied picture over here. So this is the entire list. I'll just skip this part over here. So different classifications have been given by the Roper Hall or the modified Hughes and the DUA classification. The major thing that they stress on is that the limbal involvement how much is the limbal involvement. So coming to the management, the goals is there to remove the offending agent, to promote ocular surface healing, controlling inflammation, preventing infection, and also controlling the IOP. The immediate management is to do a thorough saline wash. If somebody, it can be with a normal saline, RL or a BSS, or sometimes if nothing is available, even tap water is good enough, you have to just wash and extensively wash for about 20 minutes or so, evert the lid, double evert the lids, and look for any particles. These Chuna particles, they stick on there, they got a lot, so basically you have to remove a lot of that. So the history, then you can take a detailed history. Coming to the medical management, steroids are the mainstay of treatment. So steroids have to be given. You start prednisolone acetate. You can start dexamethasone. You can give steroid ointment as well. Coming to the ascorbic acid can be given. However, it is difficult to obtain, and along with citric acid. Tetracycline such as doxycycline can be given BD because these are collagenase inhibitors and also inhibit the neutrophil activity and hence by reducing the ulceration as well. So another thing is you have to give a lot of lubricants, topical antibiotics to prevent the infection. Sometimes if there's an epithelial defect, BCL can be applied. Autologous serum also has its roles. So IOP can be given by giving oral acetazolamide or beta blockers as the initial therapy. The IOP control, the initial rise takes place because of the inflammation part, and the second later end is because of the prostaglandin release. So later management also depends a lot on the lid formation, what deformity has formed. You can go for a conjunctival or mucous membrane graft at times also. Some people, you don't have an amniotic membrane available, what you can do is you can do a tenonplasty, is that, you know, remove all the necrotic conjunctiva, all that ischemic area, all that necrotic area, and you can just advance the tenons onto the cornea where there's a problem over there. So I'll just show you a video of this is a photo. So is a non-healing epithelial defect that you see. So the amniotic membrane has got anti-fibrotic properties, it's anti-inflammatory, anti-angiogenic, and basically also covers the raw surface, so that this is a very good, and it's easily available everywhere. Another the landmark thing that came out is the SLET. Now, in SLET tissue, what you do is you just take out from the other eye, and sometimes if it's the other eye is also bad, then you can ask from a relative, and you take out this limbal stem cells from this area. And so this is a very post-chemical injury. This was a very big panus over here. So you'll be surprised when you start dissecting, and this patient was a young girl, 16-year-old. She had a lot of problems. And when you start dissecting it, you will actually be surprised. You can see a clear cornea over there. So this patient is doing well right now after 3 months of the surgery. And after this, you can apply an amniotic membrane, and that tissue that you had taken, You cut that into multiple small pieces and put it in two rings onto the place, apply it with fibrin glue, and then later on you can put a bandage contact. This can be done by a general ophthalmologist. This is not a difficult procedure. You just need to see a couple of videos. Dr. Basu's videos on YouTube are excellent on this. So sometimes you can go for a PK for that. Obviously, you'll refer to a cornea surgeon. And other options are the keratoprosthesis. So I'll just say prevention is very important for such cases. So education and training of the people around you is extremely important. And in workplaces like factories, tell them to wear, you know, goggles for protection. Thank you so much.
So that was a wonderful presentation, Karan. I have a question. Yeah. So in a previous talk about the management of lens during the corneal tear, so how do we plan it? So one of the videos we saw, there were sutures and you're managing the cataract as well. So how would you plan a cataract surgery in those? Your take on that?
See, you have to see the area of the trauma is the weak area. So you have to go a little bit away from that. Your ports have to be a little bit away from that. And you see, important, I always believe that you have to make your surgery easy. So you can shift around for the incision part. And the other problem is that you have a scar over there, so the visualization becomes a problem. But if what I did in that video that I had shown is that the synechia was there with the cornea. So I left it because that was attached, that was actually acting kind of like an iris hook. And also when you rotate the globe, that retro movement also gives you a good view. And if there is a problem, you can always use hooks to remove the iris. And I guess, yeah. And yeah, always be ready for intraoperative surprises. Be slow and, yeah.
And another thing is, would you first go for a suture removal and let the cornea stabilize to get the keratomatous stabilized?
Yes, yes. This patient, you know, was insistent. That's why we had done it. But ideally, what you would do is, if there's no inflammation in the eye, you can go for a cataract surgery, ideally after 3 months of the suture removal, yeah.
I think we can wrap up this session. If there are any questions, you can personally ask any of us.
And I apologize to the next set of speakers for delaying our session a bit. Thank you so much.